Welcome to WO50 Podcast, Women Over 50 in Body Wisdom and Wellness.
Oh yeah, we do. That was Eddie, and my name is Corinne. And our title today is Fueling Your Brain, Nutrition, Meditation, and Lifestyle for People, Women Over 50.
Mm-hmm. Yes, and yeah. We talked about a lot of things. We talked about the foods that are really good for us to fuel.
The supplements.
We talked about sleep, meditation,
exercise,
and learning. Learning the most important. Yes, yeah. We did. It was yeah. really.
And we gave you all kinds of little tips and tricks, like, you know, don't start anything too fast, like just, you know, one thing at a time. But, you know, hopefully there's a lot of information out there, and hopefully what we did is we made it fun and condensed it and made it, you know, relatable and easy for you to do in your own life.
Yes, it's like build a brain.
I love it. I hope you enjoy it as much as we did. Hi, Ed.
Hello, Ken. How are you doing?
I'm very, very good. I'm almost good. Over jet lag.
Oh, boy.
Is it like at 9 o'clock every night, I start to feel like very woozy, which is not a normal thing for me. So I'm going to try to stay on it, though. I'm going to try to stay because I've got that retreat next weekend and it's an hour ahead. So I'm going to try to stay going to bed early and waking up. I was wide awake at 5 a.m. this morning, which, as you know, is not like me.
Yeah. But it was really another time somewhere else. So it's really, but we don't look at those other times.
No, I'm just very excited about
your time.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. How are you doing?
Good. I'm good. You look all tanned and I look really white. Like we have about, I think it's over 80 centimeters of snow right now. Yeah.
How many is that in regular language?
That's a lot of feet. So it's stacked up. I know I backed up my car and my bank of snow was 8 feet.
Oh my gosh.
I know.
That's nutty.
Yeah, it is. But
you just get used to it though. And all your roads are cleared, so it's fine.
Oh yeah, for sure. And you've done a lot of traveling, so your little brain has to adjust.
Yeah, speaking of that, what am I doing to fuel my brain?
I wonder. We're going to talk about that today, especially after 50, right? The age,
yeah.
You know.
The brain changes. Too. You know, I heard years ago that the frontal cortex, which is your like executive functioning and all the, you know, that's what is bigger now that we're in this society now that's different than the caveman days, stops growing after, I think it's 40. Unless you meditate.
Meditation is one of the most important things to do for the brain. Do you know what? And the other thing that's really, really important, one of the key things we need to do in our life to keep the brain growing, new brain cells formulating all the time. The brain is always developing new cells as long as we're doing some of these things, which we're going to talk about. But the most important one is that we are learning, that we are continually learning.
Yeah, learning new things. Yeah.
Learning new things, learning and anything that stretches you, right? So, you know, the brain needs to grow. It needs to be, you know, it's made up of fat and water. And everything we eat, every single thing we eat has a direct effect on the brain. So when we eat really well, and, you know, the brain is really important to me now because I just finished a seminar on it. So it's all really fresh in my brain, which I'm excited to share the information, which is great. So, you know, and a lot of these amazing experts spoke about the importance of fueling our brain with the right food. And they've done MRI studies where they watched the brain activity when it ate like dead food, like fast food. And then when you add in like an avocado or pomegranate or something that, you know, that is a fruit or a vegetable, and they watched the brain actually light up. So it was rejuvenating new cellular tissue. So this is really important that we eat right, especially as we get older, because the brain gets lazy. And people, what are the first signs of, you know, we think of aging? We're getting forgetful, or what else? Can't remember somebody's name or where you laid the car keys. And I always say we should start to worry when we don't know what the car keys are for. When we place them, you know, we just got to get a routine going where the placement is. But there's routines and little things we can do to really support our brain, and supplementation that we need to take that, you know, we'll talk about here as well. That is really important. The most important time in our lives to feed our brain is right now, because it's connected to the body and it rules. It rules everything. Yeah.
And you don't have to. I think the reason why, well, why we think about as we age that our memory isn't so good, I think, is because it's like as we get older, maybe people go in retirement and they're not in the mode of learning as many things. But you see people when they, even after they retire, if they're like traveling or taking dance classes or, you know, learning a new sport, you know, or staying, you know, going, helping their grandchildren with their, you know, homework or whatever, they're the people that do stay younger. It's those people that, you know, that go into, go into the awful nursing homes where there's no stimulation if they don't have any family, and that they age so quickly.
Yes. And those beautiful nursing homes where they have recreational programs and they have areas where people connect and play games and learn a new language and or line dancing, right? And they're laughing and there's so much, and they're sharing recipes and they're learning how to cook. And, you know, we got to do the work. And in our 50s and 60s, 70s, we really have to add to our bodies what the body isn't making and creating anymore.
Mm-hmm.
Can't get lazy there. We can't just go, oh, I can eat junk food all day long and don't need to eat well, and I can just laze around and watch TV and watch these endless, you know, nothing. Binging. You're learning nothing from.
Yeah, that's the thing is, I was hanging out with a friend of mine who's, you know, 34 years old in India, a young virile man who's, you know, strong, and you know, there's just such a difference. There, it seems like there's such a difference in the energy level and stuff, because we tend to slow down as we get older, but we don't. I mean, we've talked about this before, is that you can slow down and do different things. Like, so you may not want to run 10 miles anymore, and you may not want to play tennis anymore or racquetball, but you'll want to play pickleball, you know, just changing activities to suit where you are, but it doesn't mean just like stopping altogether.
And you don't want to blame your brain for that. Oh, I can't play that sport because I can't remember what I'm supposed to do, you know, or so this is why it's really important that we understand that every morsel of food you put into your mouth affects the brain, which affects every part of the body.
Yeah.
The meditation, it's so important. I mean, they have proven that, and it's so nice to listen to all these scientists talk about it right now. And these are guys that, you know, work in integrative medicine, Dr. Mark Hyman and Dr. Perlmutter, there's father and son, and a lot of amazing, Dr. Bland, like a lot of amazing people. There's Dr. Amen out there that's talking about the brain. And the brain finally is put on a pedestal right now, and it should be, because this is our hard wire. This is our computer core, you know?
Mm-hmm.
This is our operating system.
The hard drive operating system, exactly.
And we have neurons that need to be fed good food. And one of the most important supplements that we should be taking right now, and eating foods high in this, is omega-3.
Mm-hmm. I had salmon tonight for dinner.
Yep, me too. So salmon, cold water fish, fatty fish. And, you know, some of us don't like sardines and mackerel and herring and all those things. I know, but they're so good for the brain. So if we don't eat enough of those fishes, those fatty fish, we need to supplement, because the body needs, the brain especially needs, about 1,000 to 2,000 milligrams of EPA and DHA. And most of the things out there contain 250 milligrams or 500 milligrams of each of those. So when we find an omega-3 supplement, we want to get something that has it in a higher amount.
How much does this piece of fish have?
It doesn't have a lot. Like, it has some, but it's not giving you a couple of hundred milligrams. It's giving you...
So I should still take my supplement even though I had salmon?
Yes, because you're not eating salmon every day, and your brain needs that omega. It needs that fat every day. It needs that fuel. That's what fuels it. It's like women that, you know, they're very low in estrogen, and they can't function, they can't think, they can't operate, and they need bioidentical hormone, estrogen, right? Which helps them, and it balances things out. So the brain really fuels up on the omegas big time.
Yeah. And it's made of fat. I mean, the thing is that the brain is made of fat and water, as you said. And as we get older, I know the appetite, not necessarily after 50, but like after 75, 80, you're definitely start eating less, because you are expending less calories too. Like you might be walking and playing golf, but you're not, like, you know, maybe not be playing as much pickleball anymore. And so you need to make sure you get your fats then. I think there are a lot of elderly people that have memory issues simply because they don't, and water too, they don't have enough fat and water.
Yes, exactly. And all those, when you think about the network, the brain, what it communicates, what you know, the pathways there, it's just overwhelming. And to think that, like, even, you know, I love this line that the new medication out there now to help the brain is exercise.
Mm-hmm. The new one.
It just means movement. It's a new one. Yeah.
Yeah.
People are prescribing it left and right, you know. Yeah.
Yeah.
But but movement is important. Yoga, breathing.
I've got my little trampoline I jump on here.
Get the heart rate up, right? Little cardio.
Yeah. So there's nutrition and supplements. So what kind of foods feed the brain?
Well, fish.
Yeah.
Lots of fish. Anything with polyphenols in it. So
olive oil.
Polyphenols are phytonutrients.
Yeah.
They are in every fruit and vegetable that has a color. So if you look at pomegranate and pineapple and mango and cabbage, red cabbage,
berries.
You're looking at all your berries, like all the colors.
Yeah. Nice.
And the other things, what I love too is tea, green tea is very powerful. So it has a lot of antioxidants in it, a lot of nutrients. But what's beautiful about tea is you can get in a lot of nutrients really quickly.
Yeah.
And with a lot of flavor, you know, and like I know you make a really amazing hibiscus tea, which now I make, right? But it's so high in vitamin C, and the body doesn't make its own supply of vitamin C. We have to take that in.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So today, actually, I brought back some tea from India. I brought back the favorite rose Tulsi, and then I had hibiscus. And I made some mate, and then I put some rose water in it, and it was so good. I love rose water in almost anything.
I do too. I love that flavor.
Hibiscus and rose water is a lovely mixture.
When you're saying it there now, I'm just like, I can taste the rose Tulsi tea.
Yeah. I brought back a bunch, so I can send you some.
Oh, good. I'm all out.
Yeah. My suitcase was chock full of like incense and tea. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, the other thing too, B vitamins.
B vitamins,
we know, are really important. So B, C, D.
Mm-hmm.
And even A, like if we do the alphabet, A, B, C, D, E, they're all really important. And A, we get, you know, we get a lot of, like in beta carotene, we get vitamin A in carrots and peppers. And, you know, there's vitamin C in lots of red and green and yellow and orange peppers too.
Mm-hmm.
So again, it's the colorful foods. When you change up the colors, you make, you know, salads or soups or stews, like you can get a lot of nutrients in. It's brain food. Mm-hmm. And your brain communicates to your gut, right? We talked about that before, the brain gut, the microbiome of the gut. Well, this middle piece here, we have a microbiome in our mouth too, which a lot of people forget about. So that's really important. All that bacteria, and the brain communicates to the body. If there's, just say you have gingivitis or you keep getting cavities, your brain is communicating to your body that there's a bacterial issue. That's information that we need to look at, because there's something trying to present if we don't address that right away.
I used to have I actually had a lot of cavities as a kid, but then as I got older, I wouldn't go to the dentist for a long time. And then the dentist, I wouldn't have any cavities, even though I wouldn't have my teeth cleaned for like 3 years. I hate having my teeth cleaned. It's the opposite of you.
I go twice a year.
I know. And so when I had this one dentist tell me, he said, your saliva, you've got really good saliva. So yes, I brush my teeth twice a day and I do floss, but it has the difference. And that's what you're talking about, right? Is that,
yeah, because your saliva, you know, you look at people who are prone to strep. That's
right.
Bacterial infection or tonsillitis, or every time there's a viral thing, they have a sore throat, or, you know,
well,
your
that is
body
me.
will, what's that?
That's one of the first things that happens to me is I get a sore throat.
Yeah, but you take things like you up your vitamin C and D, and you gargle and you colloidal silver, and you have these things, right, that we take to ward it off. So what you're doing is you're balancing out your microbiome in your mouth, which is also feeding into your gut, which is also communicating back to the vagus nerve, which is going to the brain, which is telling the body, oh, back off, pull out the troops, no alarm. Alarm bells, let's dimmy down the lights here. There is no infection. We're going to fix this. Or the lights go up and there's more little macrophages and white count goes up and the body is getting ready to attack. So that's what inflammation is. It's the body. It's good to have a little inflammation or it's like a little stress, right? It's good to have a little bit, because that keeps the body kind of functioning and doing its thing. But too much is too much. Yeah. And if we take too many things that are, you know, an antibiotic, and here we could have drank some vitamin C, we could have taken some tea, right? Some echinacea, amped up some natural remedies like soup and bone broths and things like that, then we can ward off the need for antibiotics.
Nice.
Because we don't want to overuse antibiotics.
Yeah. I'd usually do garlic capsules or tablets. I use that as my natural antibiotic, that and oregano oil and olive leaf.
I know we could do a whole podcast on what's a cold,
natural.
What's a flu, and how to.
Yeah. I'm about to make me a ginger bug. Cause we're going to be, it's winter's not over yet, but it's feels like it a little bit here. And this is always the time of year when I want to start planting, and I can plant cold weather things, you know,
I'll
make
fun.
a ginger bug, you know, and that's that little fermented ginger that you can add to different things. So,
Yum. And ginger is another super, right? It's a super antioxidant, great for the gut, great for the mouth, great for the brain.
Yeah.
Wakes us up, you know. You just think about when you bite into ginger, you know, what wakes you up. And
so much. And so it helps the belly, helps with nausea. Ginger is so wonderful. Okay, so we've got the supplements, we've got the food, we've got exercise, we've got rest,
sleep.
So sleep and meditation is also a deep rest for the body and the brain.
And a little nap. Napping's not bad. Napping's not a bad thing. You know, you see people, they go, I feel guilty lying down or taking a rest. You're resting your brain. You're resting your body.
Yeah.
It's really important.
Yeah. Or a nice relaxing yoga class or something. The thing is what's so interesting is that naturally at about 4 or 5 o'clock every day, we all feel a little dull in the body and in the brain, in the mind too. We feel a little bit dull. So people will reach for their caffeine then instead of meditating or taking rest. So you're overriding your, so really what needs to happen is there's nothing wrong with a cup of coffee, you know, but if you're using it to energize you, that's not so good, or to clarify you, because there's healthier ways to get clarity. And that's one of the reasons why I love meditating or napping, whatever it is you're resting in the afternoon, to refuel your brain so that then you have a full enjoyable evening. I talk to people about that almost every day, because because we've got so much coming at us all the time, so much, you know, whether it's social media or computers or everything's so immediate, we have so much on our plate on a day-to-day basis that of course it's natural that we're going to be tired and worn out by 4 or 5 o'clock, but we want to enjoy our lives, not just have our working day. We want to enjoy our evenings. So what can we do that's not like drinking a bunch of coffee to have an enjoyable evening. And that's like meditating, rest, napping, just rejuvenating, re-energizing, giving your brain a rest.
Yeah. And the body, well, and it's something that your body doesn't have to process. It's not a chemical. It's ready and available. So caffeine, you have to process this. Caffeine is a drug. Like it's alcohol, right? The THC, CBD medications, they're drugs. They have to be processed. So even with caffeine, some people, it's a major stimulant and it's terrible for them. And other people, it can really sharpen the brain because, you know, it's not what you put in the coffee, cream and sugar, leave it out. You need to do your coffee black or a plant-based creamer, right? With very little sugar. But coffee has amazing antioxidants in it. So, but one cup max two in the morning, and usually the best time to consume them, which I've just learned. I always knew you had to delay it a little bit, but I didn't know by how much.
From the time you wake up to the time you take a stimulant should be at least an hour and a half.
Yes, 90 minutes. And the other reasoning for it is now that the studies and all this, they do the double blinds and all that, which, you know, I don't need them, but it's kind of cool when some of them are done correctly. And they said that that lag you get in the afternoon, when you delay that caffeine stimulant, it will actually have this double kick in later. So you don't need that.
So there's a chemical in your brain that it keeps you sleep. Well, you're sleepy in the morning and it takes about an hour to an hour and a half for it to wear off naturally. And so if you take caffeine before it wears off naturally, you're just covering up that. So that chemical is still in your brain and that makes you tired later in the day. Is that right?
Yep. You're right on. That's it. Yeah. Because it's all latent. So then you get the time where you can meditate, you can mix up your, you know, even your green tea or your golden milk drink, like a coconut milk drink with some turmeric and ginger and pepper, you know, mixed together and they're lovely. Nice. Just change some things up a little bit. Learn, you know, a new meditation technique, learn something that will help you calm in the afternoon.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. In India, I went for a massage one morning and I didn't have my tea in the morning, and which I don't need to have my tea in the morning, but I went, and then they had this warm milk that they'd put turmeric and pepper and lemongrass and like mint and cardamom. Yum. And they served it to me and it was so good before my massage. These two young women, that it was just lovely. So there's so many things that we can have either in the morning or in the afternoon that can stimulate us and also nourish at the same time.
Yeah. And you're feeding your brain. You're not telling your brain, okay, let's go, let's go, let's go. You're like, you're letting it rest. You're letting it process. You're letting it assimilate. It's like if your computer gets too hot, you don't keep working on it. You shut down some windows and you let it kind of be for a minute. And that's what we have to do for ourselves. That pause is really important.
And it doesn't have to be like a 2 hour nap. Like I'm always amazed if I hit a wall at either 2, 3, 4, or 5 o'clock. And if I just take, I mean, I usually take more time to meditate, but even if I take 10 minutes to not watch TV and not write, but just actually close my eyes and sit up or lay down. Sometimes I'm so tired. I know I've got a nap before I meditate or whatever. It's amazing how much 10 minutes you just need to shut down just for 10 minutes.
That's it. The brain is your operating system. It needs a rest. It needs to rest. Digest. It needs to pause. It needs new information.
Let's get on to that now, the new information. So there's so many different ways we can have new information, like picking up an instrument that you've always wanted to learn. You know, you mentioned before you've been learning the piano along with your granddaughter. Mm-hmm. I mean, how fun is that? And it can connect and good for your brain.
Great for the brain. Pickleball. This is why it's so common amongst this age group, is because there are a lot of steps to learn. But once it's in there, then it's strategy and it's fun and it's connection. Same with learning a language. You know, there's all kinds of apps, right, to learn.
Yes. Duolingo is my favorite to learn language. It's really good. I mean, there's lots of them, but I was learning Spanish for a while on that. That was really fun. We're Eddie and I both play guitar. And so I love learning new, like picking patterns on the guitar or even just new songs that creates new neural pathways.
That's writing poetry or working on our books or, you know, just learning anything, learning about the brain, learn about your digestive system, learn about a body part or about a country or, you know. Yeah.
Well, even traveling in a place where you've never been before, navigating, like I was in London and, you know, I had a little map telling me where to go, but I had to remember, like, I don't like to just rely on the little map. I like to remember where I'm going so that I could find my way back if I need to.
So important. Yeah. Those little road signs, like even try that when you're somewhere like really where, like, I don't know, Paris or Germany or something, and just cover a territory. And then we did that in Sicily. And then we were kind of like mice. We found our little route. We went up the same. There probably were shorter ways, but we knew these steps and we went up the down. Oh my God, these crazy
steps. And that first day when we got lost so badly and we were both jet lagged and we were so lost. And then the next day we could see when we finally knew where we were going and we figured it out. Like we were so walking in circles and didn't even realize it. And we walked like 10 miles or something. And really all we needed to do was walk 1 mile. It's like, oh, that street's right there. Really?
Yeah. Just to take it. And then when we realize it, it's funny, but there it is. It happens, right? It's the brain. The brain is so amazing and so beautiful. And, you know, even the studies now with concussed brains and injuries, brain injuries that a lot of people have as you get older from falls and things like that. It's really, really important to make sure you fuel the body right, like you eat the right stuff, you rest it properly, just to allow it that time. You meditate, you take the naps, you know, you want it to grow these new cells. And there's so much out there, like the science that's happening now behind mental health, right? Mm-hmm. And now they're studying areas of the brain that and the connections and the anxiety and depression and we're getting so much information that it is information overload for many people.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, like where do you start with it? So hopefully this is like a good introduction for people of and a good, like, you know, ground rules about how to take care of your brain as you get older. I mean, we talk about it a little bit because we are a podcast that talks about everything over 50. And so we do tend to touch on a lot of these things, but this is like a deeper dive into specifically
the deeper dive into, you know, preventing dementia, and we can even prevent Alzheimer's. There's lots of blood tests that can show you if you have markers for these things, but there's a lot of signs and symptoms that present early in our life that are flags that should make us step up to the plate to go, okay, I got to, just because it's in my family doesn't mean I've got to suffer with that as well. Mm-hmm. Even if you carry the gene for Alzheimer's or dementia or any, you know, cognitive decline starts, you know, midlife, really. Mm-hmm. It might have started sooner depending on our lifestyles with if people have abused alcohol or drugs or caffeine or medications, right? Mm-hmm. And there's so much, but what we realize is there's a lot we can do to prevent the brain aging, the decline, the cognitive decline.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it starts mildly and then it goes moderately and then it goes severely. So when there's some symptoms and menopause, we sometimes feel, oh, you know, my brain is foggy. My mind is, you know, I can't think right. And then I'm like, okay, let's take sugar out of your diet, processed sugars. Let's add in, you know, the superfoods and an omega and get your ABCDs in, right? Of your vitamins. And then we can start adding in other things later. But make sure your plate's full of colorful foods. You're drinking your water. You're quenching your cells with juicy fruits and vegetables. You're drinking the right kind of teas.
Yeah. Tease is an easy one. A lot of this stuff is really just creating good habits for yourself, you know, and start with one thing at a time. Because if you try to do too many things, so maybe you just try tea. If you like tea, maybe you just start with tea. My general rule is I drink black tea in the morning because it's got a lot of antioxidants. But the green tea in the afternoon, I drink after 1 o'clock or 2 o'clock because it has a little bit of stimulant, a little bit of caffeine, but it has a lot of other really good things. And it has theanine, which does help you calm as well. So I don't drink green tea after like 6 or 7 p.m., but like in that window, and I'll drink it hot and cold and add, you know, different herbs from the garden and stuff in it. So just do it. We're just picking, you know, resting in the afternoon when you're tired instead of going for caffeine, or as Eddie had mentioned earlier, instead of drinking coffee as soon as you wake up. Have another drink without caffeine in it, and then have your coffee at 90 minutes after you wake up.
Because I, you know me, all those years, I would wake up and go down and make my coffee. And now I make my tea, my herbal tea, which is just echinacea and zinc, and there's not even caffeine in it. It's not black or green or anything. And I add my little bit of stevia and I sip on that. And then I make my coffee, and sometimes I don't even drink it. It comes with me to work.
Yeah.
And then I forget about it.
Yeah.
And my coffee anyway is only half decaf and half regular. So I've come from like lots of lovely caffeine in my coffee to maybe having it, you know, a cup a day.
Yeah.
If that. The rest of the time it's the teas, because I love the different varieties, like dandelion root tea is great for your liver, is good for your gut, it's good for your lymphatic system. There's so many teas.
Yeah, there's so many
berry teas, blueberry tea, like, and you can mix them together and have fun with herbs and just you know, my nephew was funny. He started to grab stuff from the garden, and he had lavender leaves, and I don't know what he grabbed, leaves from something, and he put them in a baggie and he made a tea out of it. And he goes, "You should drink this." And I'm like, "Do you know what all these leaves are?" He goes, "Oh yeah, my mom is a forager." He told me what to pick. I'm like, "Oh, it's so funny."
That's so great. That's so great. Yeah, it's just a matter of you know, and it's all self-care. It's all self-nourishing. I saw on Facebook today and Instagram, my friend Robbie, who's a yoga teacher in town in Nashville. She's wonderful. And they had a, instead of like a bliss day like we've done before, or one of your learning things, they did a self-care day for women, and they taught them how to make little tinctures.
But you know, that's the other amazing thing too with the brain, is that the skin, what you put on your skin, what goes into your body has to be metabolized, and the brain is always metabolizing, right? So, and it has its own immune system. Like, that's pretty amazing. And if whatever you put on the skin is communicated through the brain as well. So it's really important that we watch the toxins we put on our body.
We've talked about that, the Yucca app, and there's different apps that show what, you know, what are the toxins. And gosh, I think I thought about that. Like, when I put my bioidenticals on my skin and my hormones are so affected. And then every time I put stuff on my face and on my cream on my body every day, I think about that. That's going straight into my liver and my brain, you know?
Yeah, it's got your lymphatic system. Your brain has got to be filtered out. Your brain, you know, there are two setups, your brain and your body, right? They're connected, but they're still two separate pieces of us.
Yeah.
And it's great because our friend Kim, who always listens to us, but she said, "Oh, my favorite." When I recommend something to her, she now says, "We've created a monster actually with Kim," because she says, is it Bobby approved? And I'm like, "Bobby approved?" She goes, "Yep, Bobby Parrish, Bobby Flav. Remember the chef? He has an app. Anyway, I downloaded it. He scans everything, all the foods, it's even better than the Yucca one."
Okay. Well, we'll have to link that. You have to let me know and I'll link it in the notes below. I'll figure out. Eddie will help me with that.
It's
awesome. Yeah.
It's another good one. So
yeah. And the more we make choices like that, like healthy choices for, to go in our bodies, the more that, you know, whenever I watch a show with organic farmers or whatever the meat, you know, people or the plant people or whatever, they all say that they're just, you know, in cooperation with what the demand. So the more the demand is, the more that they'll have it there. So you might think you're not making a difference when you choose these things that might be a little more expensive that are just for you, but it's not just for you, because you're creating a demand for these people to create more natural things that will help, you know, our children and our children's children, and help the farmers and help everybody.
And the price goes down when more people like, you know, you think about it, like the less ingredients there is in something, the better. So when we go to get, you know, plant-based foods, well, it should be mostly plant-based, right? If you're getting beans, it should be just the bean in there. Yeah. Same with milks, right? It should be just oat milk. But if you see six other in or eight other ingredients, there's always another one that's a little better. And then once people catch on to the really good one, that's the one that sells, and that's the one the store keeps buying.
Yeah.
Remember years ago, you couldn't get anything gluten-free?
Yes.
It was so hard.
Well, you remember that, I'm sure.
Oh,
I remember
30 years.
Yeah.
Oh my God, it was such a pain. Like,
now there's so many choices. Do you know that they even have gluten-free choice on the plane now, on the international flight? You can choose gluten-free. So next time you take a flight,
that's great.
You don't have to pack your own snacks anymore.
No, that's good. Well, I always will anyway. Just
you always
in case.
Will. Yeah, exactly.
Say, oh, we're out of that.
Yeah. Well, that was great, Eddie. I know you were excited about this topic because you just took your course and you love learning new things. We both do, actually.
We do. We both learn. We both love learning. Like, learning's been my whole life.
Yeah.
Like, I'm going to learn the rest of my life, right? Yeah. Everything. You know, it's beautiful to be able to have this brain that you can access and grab information, and it just keeps storing. And, you know, once you realize that as soon as you learn something new, your brain is never the same again.
Yeah.
And you learn something new again, it's never the same.
I love it.
Yeah.
Yay. Thanks, Ed.
Thank you.
Love you. We love you guys. Thanks for continuing to listen and send us your messages and your hellos, and we appreciate you. Make sure you subscribe, because some of you haven't subscribed yet. We do have a lot of subscriptions, but share it with people. Share the love.
Share the love.